Pet project each year on Car and Track is a thorough ring out of the latest Shelby offering. We had this car for about 6 weeks and consequently became pretty familiar with it. The toughest part was sending it back. Driving this GT500 KR, like all Shelby cars, was pure enjoyment. Admittedly, this car was a far cry from the racetrack special they built in 1966. It's smoother, softer, quieter, and they sell a lot more of them. And since that's the reason they're in business, it's easier to understand the changes that have taken place. But like them or not, even the hardcore automotive enthusiast has to look twice at the king of the road. Here, resting at the very top of the Mustang totem pole, is the car Pamoco terms the king of the road. In fact, the KR letters are displayed prominently on both sides. And in some highly competitive circles, this title can become quite argumentative. In short, the owner of a Shelby can get a little bit tired of proving to every hot car on the street that his cobra-eyed Mustang is truly the king of the road. In fact, we felt that it was tucked neatly within the shadow of the 1966 Shelby offering. Our test car, as you can see, was the fastback model, which we felt had lines far superior to the convertible. However, rear visibility was not the best, due to the back window being about as flat as a poker table. The rear end tapered back to a built-in, not bolt-on spoiler. These air scoops draw immediate attention and tend to separate it from the average Mustang look. At least they did. Now the 69 Mach 1 has adopted them. The top scoop is functional. The bottom one is a falsie. The Shelby did all of its accelerating, cornering, and braking atop these E7015 wide oval tires, and they do make a difference, in hard, fast cornering especially. And they're mounted on a 108-inch wheelbase. As in the past, the GT500 lettering is on the front rocker panel. Only now, the KR, King of the Road, has been added. And above it is a big, bold, red 428 Cobra Jet insignia. You might have more fun without any of these. And here's the fangs of the Cobra, 428 cubic inches worth, delivering an advertised 360 horsepower at 5,400 RPMs, with 459 foot-pounds of torque at 3,200 RPMs. It squeezes out a 10.5 to 1 compression ratio and has one four-barrel carburetor. Shelby is really posh and a far cry from the rough and racy 66 version. The buckets up front are very comfortable, giving good back support, and with a high console, lateral support is excellent. The suspender-type shoulder harness is the best in the business. It'll give when you move against it slowly, but the slightest jerk will lock it up tight. The dashboard was lush and fancy. All gauges were round and recessed in foam padding. Instrumentation was clear and easy to read. The gas gauge required constant checking. This car was thirsty all the time. The steering wheel was adjustable up or down for individual driver comfort and was the tilt-away type, which makes it a little easier to get in and out. Our tester had the 3-speed automatic transmission with a selector mounted on the console. Hey, look, Mom, real louvers. These certainly helped to dissipate engine heat. However, they were cut in right over the spark plug wiring. Although heavy rain didn't seem to bother it. Scoops in the front of the hood were real, too. They tunneled air in directly to the carburetor. It's happy time. This Cobra struck fast coming out of the hole. We ran 0 to 45 in 4.1 seconds. That's quick enough to get the attention of any nearby officer. The next time we tried a 0 to 60 run and scorched that out in 6.2 seconds. The third time off the line, it took us 9.7 seconds to kick our speedo up to 75 miles an hour. Our best run through the corner was done in 14.5 seconds at 101 miles an hour. The brakes on our Shelby left a little to be desired. From 30 miles an hour, it took 41 feet to stop. We had discs up front with drums in the rear. From 45, we ended our forward motion in 66 feet. After about 15 minutes on the braking course, heat buildup was intense. Smoke was billowing out from under the front fenders, and the pedal faded to about a half inch from the floor. Our shortest stopping distance from 60 miles an hour was 161 feet. After four or five panic stops, we had to stop and let them cool down. In the cornering and handling department, the car did well. It has a softer suspension than the original version, but it hangs well in the corners, and in some cases was quite forgiving. To show maximum side roll, we took it through the reverse spin. She went through it like a veteran. Recovery out of the spin, excellent. This latest Shelby offering has a far more comfortable ride, obviously catering to that segment of the buying public that wants power and comfort. Softening it up, plus adding more chrome and flash, has definitely improved the upward climb of the sales charts. Still, body roll was not excessive. In hard, fast cornering, the front end will wash out a little, but with all that power up front, it's easy to control through a four-wheel drift. This is a 60-mile-an-hour cornering shot in ultra-slow motion. Under that front end, they employ independent suspension with coil springs. In the rear, they use the Hotchkiss suspension with semi-elliptic multi-leaf springs. You might get a lot of arguments as to whether or not the new Shelby is king of the road. The people that own them love them, and those of us that don't would sure like to.